Grace and peace be yours in fullest measure through our knowledge of God and Jesus our Lord. Welcome to the Presbyterian Church of Coshocton on this, the Lord's Day. We're grateful for the opportunity we've been given to assemble publicly in worship of our God. If you're visiting here this morning at the Coshocton Church, we're glad to share in our worship with others, and we do look forward to greeting you personally, albeit with some restrictions, during and following worship today. I would like, if I may, to call your attention to the printed order of worship. It's prepared on a single page, and if you look at the order, I think it's something that most of us will be familiar with. Sarah is serving as the liturgist this morning, and will be reading the first two lessons of Scripture. I also would like to mention a couple of you suggested last week that 50 minutes was a long time to sit, and would it be possible to stand? You know, ordinarily we're accustomed to standing when we sing and when we pass the peace, but it does make sense to me, even though I'm standing all the while, to give you an opportunity to do so. I would like to suggest when we have the affirmation of faith. Of course, that's an invitation. If you are willing and or able to stand when we get to that point, we will then say together what we believe. Now, this being an opportunity not only to greet worshipers today, but also to attend to any announcements, some which I've shared with you already. But I would like to pause in this moment and ask if anyone has anything they would like to mention or share pertaining to people or program here at the Coshocton Church. If that's the case, now would be an appropriate time to do that. It's an invitation, not an obligation. Hearing none, shall we now proceed to worship God, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
I will make one announcement. I just realized I forgot to say it at the right time. I spoke yesterday with Barb Wheeler, and she asked me to extend her greatest gratitude for all of the outpouring of love and support for her birthday last week. So she asked me to share that. Let us worship God. Will you please join me in the opening words? Come, all who hunger for good news.
We thirst for words of hope and healing.
Come, from rural road and city street.
We gather at the King's invitation.
Come, join the celebration.
Let us worship the Lord.
Thank you.
We have sinned and fallen short of what God commands and requires of us. We have no excuses, but we have confidence in the Lord's promises. Therefore, we are bold to confess our sin to God and with one another. Let us together pray. Extravagant God, you invite us to your table in the kingdom of heaven, but we do not take our place at the feast. We say we have more important things to do and turn back to labors that threaten to consume us. Beckon us again, we pray, that we may respond with gratitude. In your mercy, gather us in, that we might experience the joy of your kingdom and the taste, the abundance of your grace. Amen. The Lord's wrath relents, and God instead pours out mercy and grace. Our God refuses to give up on us and instead forgives and frees us. My friends, believe the exceedingly good news. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. And now, as God's own people, let us be merciful in action, kindly in heart, and humble in mind. Let us always be ready to forgive as freely as God has forgiven us. And above everything else, be loving and never forget to be thankful for what Christ has done for us. Amen.
Let us pray. Sovereign God, let your word rule in our heart and your spirit govern our lives until at last we see the fulfillment of your realm of justice and peace. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. A reading from the book of Exodus, chapter 32, verses 1 through 14. Hear the word of the Lord. When the people saw that Moses delayed to come down from the mountain, the people gathered around Aaron and said to him, "Come, make gods for us, who shall go before us. As for this Moses, the man who brought us up out of the land of Egypt, we do not know what has become of him." Aaron said to them, "Take off the gold rings that are in the ears of your wives, your sons, and your daughters, and bring them to me." So all the people took off the gold rings from their ears and brought them to Aaron. He took the gold from them, turned it into a mold, and cast an image of a calf. And they said, "These are your gods, O Israel, who brought you up out of the land of Egypt." When Aaron saw this, he built an altar before it. And Aaron made proclamation and said, "Tomorrow shall be a festival to the Lord." They rose early the next day, and they offered burnt offerings and brought sacrifices of well-being. And the people sat down to eat and drink and rose up to revel. The Lord said to Moses, "Go down at once. Your people, whom you brought up out of the land of Egypt, have acted perversely. They have been quick to turn aside from the way that I have commanded them. They have cast for themselves an image of a calf, and have worshipped it and sacrificed to it. And they say, 'These are your gods, O Israel, who brought you up out of the land of Egypt.'" The Lord said to Moses, "I have seen this people, how stiff-necked they are. Now let me alone, so that my wrath may burn hot against them, and I may consume them, and of you I will make a great nation." But Moses implored the Lord his God and said, "O Lord, why does your wrath burn hot against your people, whom you brought out of the land of Egypt, with great power and with a mighty hand? Why should the Egyptians say, 'It was with evil intent that he brought them out, to kill them in the mountains and consume them from the face of the earth'? Turn from your fierce wrath. Change your mind and do not bring disaster on your people. Remember Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, your servants, how you swore to them by your own self, saying to them, 'I will multiply your descendants like stars of the heavens. And in this land that I have promised, I will give you your gift to your descendants, and they shall inherit it forever.' And the Lord Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say, rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to everyone. The Lord is near. Do not worry about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Holy wisdom, holy word.
Thanks be to God.
The gospel reading today comes by way of the gospel according to Matthew, a reading in the 22nd chapter, verses 1 through 14. As I mentioned, if you were here last Sunday, that when invited to fill a pulpit, I many times like to read from a different translation of Scripture. You know, the Bible's not an English book. That's why we have so many translations. It's not a modern book, and it's not a single book. And I'm of the opinion, at least, that we benefit periodically from reading from a different translation. It helps us, I think, when we hear a passage that is familiar, to suddenly hear with new ears what the scriptures are saying to us today. And with that being said, I would like to read from the Message, and that is a translation by the late Dr. Eugene Peterson, based upon the biblical languages, but translated into a contemporary understanding. Listen again for God's word, the story of the wedding banquet. Jesus responded by telling still more stories. God's kingdom, he said, is like a king who threw a wedding banquet for his son. He sent out servants to call in all invited guests, and they wouldn't come. He sent out another round of servants, instructing them to tell the guests, "Look, everything is on the table. The prime rib is ready for carving. Come to the feast." They only shrugged their shoulders and went off, one to weed his garden, another to work in his shop, and the rest, with nothing better to do, beat up on the messengers and then killed them. The king was outraged and sent his soldiers to destroy those thugs and level their city. Then he told his servants, "We have a wedding banquet all prepared, but no guests. The ones I invited weren't up to it. Go out into the busiest intersections in town and invite anyone you find to the banquet." The servants went out on the streets and rounded up everyone they laid eyes on, good and bad, regardless. And so the banquet was on, every place filled. When the king entered and looked over the scene, he spotted a man who wasn't properly dressed. And he said to him, "Friend, how dare you come in here looking like that?" The man was speechless. Then the king told his servants, "Get him out of here fast. Tie him up and ship him to hell. And make sure he doesn't get back in." That's what I mean when I say, many get invited, only a few make it. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Well, I can tell from the expressions on some of your faces, even with masks on, that you felt that reading was rather shocking, as did I when I looked at it this past week. In fact, I almost many times leaned toward the gospel reading. But having read that, I thought, I'm going to go see what the Old Testament says today. And of course, I went back to that passage in the Torah, in the law of the Hebrew scriptures from the book of Exodus, which talks about the temptation to make and worship idols when God does not seem to be present. And then that, of course, made me relax somewhat. And I went to Philippians, which is one of my favorite letters of Paul. And it's just a wonderful letter, in part because it's shorter than longer. And Paul is always a challenge for me, at least, to read theologically. And I just delighted in this passage from the lectionary this morning that Sarah read a few moments ago from the fourth chapter of Philippians, those few verses. Well, that being said, you know, I get up and walk away from looking at these lessons and go outside and putz around. And some, of course, would say what I'm doing is procrastinating, being comfortable in the moment to sit down and try and work with these passages of Scripture. And I must confess, after 40 plus years of doing this, I'm invariably humbled in the moment. I invariably find myself thinking, who am I to say anything about these ancient words that have been recorded historically and preserved by faith communities and the church through the ages? And yet, finally, if I just settle down a little bit, relax, if you will, into God's grace, which is invariably sufficient, I am willing to kind of wrestle with the texts. And that's what I did as the week unfolded. And this is where I landed. These passages this morning left me wondering, what happens when we turn away from God and follow the devices and desires of our own hearts? How does God respond to our waywardness? Are there ways that we can stay on the path, knowing from time to time, in our humanity, we will miss the mark? Well, as a spiritual guide once said, the path of faith is a constant falling down and getting up again. While there is a harshness in the story of the golden calf and the wedding banquet, I believe this threat is meant to tell us that our behaviors have consequences, and not that God is out to get us, to dominate and destroy us, if we fall from the path. Beyond the threat of infidelity, this morning's lessons, I think, challenge us to orient ourselves toward God's way rather than the pathways of our own making. As John Calvin says, and I quote, "The human mind is a factory of idol making, and whether our idols are gun ownership, the flag, an anthem, prosperity, consumerism, they are all grounded in ideologies that put our interests ahead of God's and the well-being of others." Well, certainly the realities of Christian nationalism and racism, as well as, I might say, the baptism of Donald Trump as the protector of the faith, are contemporary images of our proclivity toward idolatry, especially in authoritarian and traditionalist faiths. Well, in contrast, God relativizes every viewpoint. Moreover, it's been my experience that God treasures innovation and creativity, even, if you will, coloring outside the lines. Yet true creativity and true freedom emerges when we blend our vision with God's vision for the well-being of ourselves and the world. Letting God be God. Aligning ourselves with God's vision enables us to go beyond self-interest to promote the well-being of our communities and the world. Well, Sarah read from the book of Exodus, and that reading invites us to consider the objects of our worship. Are we worshiping the right God or false gods of our own creation? You know, years ago in seminary, with that rather cumbersome bibliography that we invariably were encouraged to pursue, among the many listings was were the readings rather of Paul Tillich, a theologian. And many of us found Paul Tillich's dynamics of faith pivotal in the theological formation. Tillich, as you may recall, spoke of faith in terms of our ultimate concern. As you may recall, what is most important to us and the realities around us in which we center our lives. And Tillich noted that our ultimate concern asks for ultimate sacrifice and promises ultimate fulfillment. Well, I think the question of religious experience is not whether or not we will have faith, but is the object of our faith able to deliver what it promises? Will it be there for us when the foundations of our lives shake and crumble? Will it remain after the gods of our own making disappear in ineffectuality? Is it ultimate or relative and passing? Well, the children of Israel once more have a failure of trust. It seemed to be one of their traits. Moses disappears on the mountain, and guess what happens? They all become anxious. The God who delivered them is too abstract and too distant, so it seems, and not tangible enough to satisfy their need for a concrete object to worship. And Moses isn't there to reassure them. The people become anxious and calm their anxiety by creating their own God, a golden calf, finite, observable, and able to be manipulated by their worship. To ease their anxiety, they create a divinity less rather than more than themselves. Their behavior eventually evokes divine displeasure. The God of Exodus wants to destroy the people, but is persuaded by Moses to give them one more chance. But while we can rightly question such all too human images of God, too finite to be worshipful in their wrathfulness, we can recognize that worshiping creatures rather than Creator leads us from life to death. Is today's Christian nationalism or identification of Christian values with political leaders an example of our failure to trust and willingness to calm our anxiety in the face of a changing world? What is really important? Do our behaviors follow our values? Well, for example, in my pastoral ministry, I've heard many people who are parents say that family comes first. But often, family and relationships become a distant second to our professional lives. Moreover, though we speak of cultivating positive relationships with our children, we often spend more time on our iPad or cell phone than playing with them at the local playground. We want to protect innocent people, but we balk at meaningful firearms regulations that would provide greater protection for those we hold dear. To be whole, our values and behaviors need to be in sync. And practically speaking, the word God, small g, answers the question, what is really important to you? And this can be a matter of life and death, spiritually, emotionally, and physically. Well, now, we didn't read or sing the Psalter this morning. The psalm for the day was Psalm 106, and I commend it to your personal devotion. And all I'm going to say about that psalm is that for me, it proclaims God's steadfast love. God does great things, refreshing and reviving us, making a way where there is no way. And yet we exchange God's glory for objects of our own making. While we can love the Creator and our love for the creatures, we put ourselves at risk when we confuse the two. Indeed, we love creation rightly when our love for the finite and its wonder and beauty is understood in light of the infinite and universal. And as I mentioned earlier, Paul's letter to the Philippians is a favorite letter in the New Testament of mine. And this passage that Sarah read from the fourth chapter, beginning with the fourth verse, is a primer, if you will, on spiritual formation and a pathway to worshiping the right God. It begins and ends with turning toward our Creator and Companion, gratitude, intercession, praise, and joy orient our lives to the Holy One. They connect us with the larger enduring realities by which we live and move and have our being. Our faith is nurtured and shaped by living affirmatively in a world characterized today by polarization, negativity, and scarcity thinking. Paul advises his listeners and us today to live affirmatively. In focusing on the affirmative, they awaken to God's movements in their lives. The Philippians, like churches today, face the reality of limitation and scarcity, but they need not be spiritually stunted by limitations. Concreteness, another word for limitation, is the womb of possibility. We need to be realists about issues of time, talent, and treasure. And we also need to awaken to deeper realism. The open system in which we live, permeated by the subtle and occasionally dramatic movements of divine providence. Following his counsel to, quote, think on these things, end quote. That is the positive aspects of life. Paul makes two bold affirmations. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me, and my God will supply all my needs. Connected with God, new energies and possibilities emerge, and while we cannot do the impossible, what seemed impossible now suddenly seems within our reach. And now, finally, we go to this gospel reading. There's no other way to say it. This parable is brutal and it's violent if taken literally. Its vision of the realm of God lacks inclusion and gracefulness and leaves no room for error. The king, the story tells us, is easily angered and even vindictive to those who are unable to attend his banquet, some of whom may have good reasons not to attend. In anger, the king reaches out to invite the entire community, regardless of their status or standing. But the king, the story tells us, is still peeved, his ire extending to those who have said yes to his invitation. Indeed, if you aren't dressed properly, you will be beaten and thrown out. Well, such actions are not worthy of a gracious God, but more like those of an imperious and immature national leader. We dare not worship such a king, nor imitate his behavior, still saying yes to God's realm opens us to an array of possibilities. Saying no closes the door to the fullness of divine generosity. I kept wondering as I looked at the passage, is there hope for the naysayers? The realm of God must always be a place for a place of second and third chances. Consequences are real, but the deeper judgment of God, of God's love, makes a way to wholeness for those who have failed time after time. So in closing, these scripture readings, I believe, invite us to consider both our values and our spiritual practices. Philippians gives us a guidepost to faith formation, which can transform our lives and experience of reality. Trusting God, opening through spiritual practices, opens us to surprising energies and lively adventures as companions in God's realm. And to Christ be the glory. Amen. Let us pray. Lord, we rejoice in you always, even in times of trial and despite seasons of doubt and pain. We rejoice. We come to you pleading on behalf of the world you so love, asking for signs of your grace, interventions of your mercy, transformation that reflects your goodness. When we grow weary and bereft, send your Spirit to encourage and uphold us. When we are tempted to give in to violence or force, remind us that we, your people, are to be known for our gentleness. Be near to us, that we might know your peace. Grant us the strength of faith not to worry, but to instead think on things that are honorable. Help us to live with an integrity, showing respect to your creation and love to your neighbors. May our actions reflect your character, the body of Christ, as an extension of Jesus' earthly ministry until he comes again. Give us the courage to not only think about justice, but enact and embody it. Aid us in our work for equity and our honest accounting of past wrongs and present oppression, knowing that we are united in Christ and called to a ministry of reconciliation. Empower us to do the hard, tangible work of repairing the breach and restoring the streets. Reveal to us that which is pure, those things that speak of your holiness and point to your will. Do not let us be overtaken by cynicism or despair. Give us eyes to see you present and at work, ears to hear your voice, however, and through whomever you choose to speak, hearts inscribed with your word and moved to do your work. Teach us to recognize that which is pleasing in your sight so that we can name it, emulate it, expand it. In the suffering so pervasive and varied in our world, call forth hope and embolden us to be bearers of it. Surround those bent over in grief and pain with disciples who refuse to turn away, people committed to sitting in the darkness until the dawn comes. Open our mouths to proclaim your praise. As our anxieties grow and our divisions increase, send the Holy Spirit to remind us of all Jesus taught us Give us the right words to speak at the right time, and turn our thoughts to you so that we will think and act on your loving kindness, your free flowing justice, your pursuit of goodness and mercy. We pray in the name of Jesus, our Savior, your Son. In his name, amen.
Thank you.
planting the seeds of your love in our world and in our lives. As we bring our gifts to you, may they be seeds of your grace, peace, and love, planted deeply in our community. And hear us as we continue our prayer, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory of forever. Amen.
Return no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Carry the weak. Help the suffering. Honor all people. Love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the fellowship and the power of the Holy Spirit. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all now and always. Alleluia. Amen.